Turn me around, turn me around, turn me around, ain't gonna let no misery. Turn me around, keep on walking, keep on talking, keep on singing, keep on swinging, gonna build a brand new world. Ain't gonna let no misery turn me around, turn me around, turn me around, ain't gonna let no misery turn me around, keep on walking, keep on.
She has been walking and talking, singing and marching for more than 20 years. The brand new world of her dreams is still a dream, but Joan Baez, America's most famous folk singer and pacifist, is still on the march. This time, for the Cambodian refugees.
Turn me around, turn me around, turn me around, ain't gonna let no misery. Turn me around, keep on walking.
The Cambodia March for Survival brought together more than 150 persons from Europe and the USA sharing a common concern for the innocent victims of war. Starting from the border village of Aranyapratet in Thailand, Joan Baez is part of a group trying to bring 20 truckloads of food and medicine into Cambodia. That Joan Baez is taking part in this march is no coincidence, but the logical consequence of her convictions and beliefs, which she has consistently manifested for the past 20 years. In her own words, "I am a nonviolent soldier, at war with war, and all the things it connotes." Ever since she first burst on the music scene in the 60s, the Madonna of folk song, as the New York Times called her, has been a crusader. She marched with Martin Luther King for civil rights, protested against the draft and against the war in Vietnam, called attention to the plight of the farm workers in Delano, and opposed capital punishment in San Quentin. In her own words, "I have always tried to mix music and social action. I don't like the word career. Music is not my life, it is part of my life."
I think that singers and songwriters can do a lot, but not just their music. I mean, there are kind of a lot of myths floating around in the 60s, and one of the common ones was music's going to change the world. You know, that Woodstock was somehow going to change the world because it was so beautiful. You know, and man, everybody's going to get the spirit and it's all going to happen. And it's sort of California sunshine talk. There are two ways to look at it. One is, I think it's impossible to make a revolution with music only. On the other hand, I don't like to be involved in any kind of social change that doesn't include music. But there has to be an element of seriousness that a lot of people are not willing to commit themselves to. It doesn't mean you have to be serious. A serious person and never smile. No, but it does mean something about you has to be serious about other people's lives and the conditions of other people's lives. And then you find that you may have to take a risk once in a while that you hadn't planned on. And I think that's when you move away from thinking that music alone can change the world.
Imagine there's no country.
Joan Baez lives today in a rustic but comfortable house in Woodside, California. Daughter of a Mexican professor and a Scottish mother, Joan Baez first came to national attention when she made an unheralded appearance at the Newport Festival in 1959. A star is born, a young soprano with a thrilling and well-controlled projection, so Bob Shelton of the New York Times. In the 60s, a new wind was blowing. There was music in the air, and America's youth began to dream of a brand new world full of love and the brotherhood of all mankind. Music was a common denominator, and they began rediscovering the old ballads of England, the country music of the South, and the blues of the blacks. Together with many colleagues, Pete Seeger. Peter, Paul, and Mary.
Always be courageous, stand upright and be strong, and may you stay. For
In a cover story, Time magazine wrote, "Her voice is as clear as the air in autumn, a strong and vibrant soprano. It is like the magical and haunting voice of a mother. It reminds one of the blues of the South and often recalls the sad songs of the Spanish gypsies."
May your feet always be swift. May you have a firm foundation when the winds of change shift. May your heart always be joyful. May your song always be sung. And may you stay.
In the late 60s, she had founded an organization in Carmel for the study of nonviolence. For the last year, she has devoted all her energies to the new foundation called Humanitas.
Humanitas is just a name that we put on a small group of people who we are. We meet here in this house, and we have an office in town. We would like to keep ourselves small. We are dedicated to educating the public about human rights violations. Our official title is International Human Rights Committee, and we chose that on purpose. I don't suppose that we will always be centering all our activities on Indochina. We don't have enough people, and we're not well-structured enough to go any beyond that. So since last March, you know, less than a year, we've been doing only work about Indochina, trying to raise people's consciousness about human rights violations whenever and wherever they occur. And so far, we've only dealt with Indochina. We don't have enough people to go beyond that.
We've watched them leaving, seen their ragged flight.
Seldom in the history of mankind has there been anything more tragic and heartrending than the plight of these refugees fleeing disease, hunger, and war, and seeking sanctuary in Thailand. They form an unending, grisly cavalcade of specters, many in the last stages of malnutrition, others ravaged by such diseases as dysentery, tuberculosis, and malaria. In 1975, Cambodia had a population of 8 million people. As many as 4 million have died since then. Baez was an eyewitness in October 1979 as the first wave of refugees poured into Thailand.
We're at the Cambodian border, and the very, very first day of the influx of people from Cambodia into Thailand, and there were 20,000 people, just like zombies, just stumbling around, little children very sick. Most of them had malaria or tuberculosis or both, and worms and intestinal problems, and just zombies. You know, your feelings range from a state of kind of traumatization and shock, to compassion, to fear, to realizing that you can't possibly absorb all the feelings living as I've lived and will probably continue to live with everything that I need and many of the things that I want. But it does things to you inside when you see people literally starving to death.
I hear there are very few children from ages 1 to 5. It takes more than jungle. Keep the young ones alive. I hear some of the rice got through. The outside's trying to send to you. There you sit in the ruins of war. The doctors are waiting at your door. And we will try and feed you, try and go to you. People of Cambodia, Cambodia, Cambodia. border, in the crowded camps. I've seen mothers giving birth, seen beautiful orphans dance. An old man turns and covers his eyes. He was never supposed to cry.
Today, the refugees are herded into makeshift camps in Thailand. They have a fragile roof over their heads, but the aid being provided is far from adequate. The camps are expanding faster than they can be staffed and supplied. Joan Baez and her organization, Humanitas, together with the San Francisco Examiner and KRON Television, raised over $1 million in the Bay Area alone. And the money was used to bring urgently needed food and medicines into these camps.
And call another conference, and write another song, and deliver another ton of rice, and hope it gets where it belongs.
But how long can $1 million worth of food and medicine keep over 1 million refugees alive? And how long can a country like Thailand, with its own economic and social problems, bear the additional burden of almost 1 million refugees? Life in the camps for these refugees is a life without hope, a day-to-day existence. In the words of Joan Baez,
and the main malady there is boredom. I mean, just boredom in a very bad psychological state, because they feel as if you sit in a camp for 4 years and wonder if you'll ever get out, or what's the point of your life? You'll know you'll never go home, etc.
No tomorrows in Cambodia. Still we'll try and feed you, try and show you. Kampuchea, Cambodia. Is there only sorrow in Cambodia? Are there no tomorrows in Cambodia?
For a politically active singer who was once an opponent of the American involvement in the Vietnam War, Baez showed remarkable courage when she took out advertisements in newspapers denouncing Hanoi for its human rights violations. Has Joan Baez changed sides?
No, because you see, I was never pro-Vietnamese. I was pro-people. I was as concerned if an American fighter was killed in his plane. I was, and people with me often didn't agree with that or like it, because I was supposed to be pro-Hanoi. I was never pro-Hanoi. I've never been pro any government. I've been pro-people. I've been pro-life, and I've been against violence. And that's very hard to define to people, because people in general have their own particular area that they're going to protect their own violences. And I don't feel like that. I don't feel... If I've betrayed anybody in the last year, I've betrayed the 17 or 18 people who are currently running Vietnam and doing a rotten job of it. And I feel as though my loyalties have stayed with the people. They're not in tiger cages now, they're in connex boxes. They're in re-education centers, they're in prisons, they're in the new economic zone. Those are all nice euphemisms for a really terrible way to live.
June, in the 60s, you and Jane Fonda fought side by side against the war in Vietnam. Now you two appear to be on opposite sides. What exactly is the nature of the controversy between you and Jane Fonda?
It's not between Jane and me, but there is definitely a difference in the way that I fought in the 60s. For instance, the press, of course, has never thought of this. I was never on a platform with Jane Fonda. I never shared an afternoon. I never shared a platform. And the reason is that most of what I did throughout the 60s, I did with other groups of people who were nonviolently oriented, and the things we had to say would be similar. I was never very fond of coalition fronts, because a lot of what happened in those are people speaking as though they were speaking for all of us, and I didn't feel comfortable with a lot of that rhetoric. I was not pro-Hanoi. I was not pro-revolution. I didn't think the revolutionary guns were any kinder than anybody else's guns. And so it's not as though we were really fighting sisters all through the 60s. That's kind of a myth as well. There were similar things that we were fighting for, but there were big differences in that. And I think that the clearest way to say it is I'm anti-war, and many people from the 60s are anti-imperialist aggression. or however you want to say it. Some wars for them are going to be okay, and some wars are not going to be okay. For me, as far as I'm concerned, any war is going to add to building up for the next war and the next war and the next war, and the ultimate goal seems to be the end of the human race. And I don't know whether you'll have to bleep this or not, but I think when Tolstoy said, somebody asked Tolstoy once what the difference was between reactionary violence and revolutionary violence, and he said it's very simple. It's the difference in dog shit and cat shit.
So you believe that nonviolence is the only solution to the problems of the world today?
I think nonviolent action, nonviolent revolution, nonviolent disobedience. The word nonviolence is kind of amorphous unless you attach it to something. But certainly to continue using conventional warfare and conventional weapons, we don't have a chance. Because now a small war is considered in terms of small nuclear weapons. Let's not have a big war, let's just have a little one, a little conventional war. That means just a bomb like the one we dropped on Hiroshima. You know, that's what we're talking about. We're talking about that kind of gross violation of people's lives, of burning up children when we talk about it. And so that we're going to solve problems. It's just absolutely extraordinary that we have the gall to go on talking like that, let alone go on building them, because I do believe that the more you build, the more we build, and the more it spreads around, little countries have them, third world countries have them, everybody's going to have their nuclear arsenal. Each time one is added, then it heightens the danger of something being used, either intentionally or otherwise.
The Cambodia March for Survival is a typical example of the nonviolent actions that Joan Baez speaks about. During a press conference in Bangkok on the eve of the march, the organizers defended their actions against criticism from the left and the right. The highly publicized march with so many representatives from Europe and the USA had been attacked in the press as a meaningless and futile gesture. Baez, as articulate as ever, clearly stated the main aims of the marchers.
In this room today are people from the right wing and from the left wing, people like myself who have no wing. But what I feel that people here, whether they prefer to hold on to their ideologies or not, for this instance, are willing to create a third wing, which is more important to them at this time than any other ideology they may have held up until now. And that we really want to say to Hanoi, to Phnom Penh, to the rest of the world, to anybody who will listen, that if the remainder of the Cambodian race is not allowed to survive, it is not because of a lack of caring from the outside world. It's not
march to the border. The march was organized by the French organization called Médecins Sans Frontières, Doctors Without Frontiers, and the International Rescue Committee. Besides Joan Baez, many well-known personalities took part in this symbolic gesture, including Norwegian actress Liv Ullmann, French author Bernard-Henri Lévy, civil rights leader Bayard Rustin, Holocaust survivor Elie Wiesel, and Leo Chern, president of the International Rescue Committee.
As far as I understand, I feel she's here for a humanitarian cause, and I feel that was what she was doing then as well. I think if you want to help people that are suffering and suppressed, you don't ask for their political views. And I think she didn't ask for their political views then, although this I don't know. Mm-hmm. I know as a fact that she's not asking now what the political views are. People are people, and it's making the distinctions that are making the wars in the end.
I can only say that I think Joan Baez takes the view that she is against starvation, and I am happy to be with her. I am not here to judge her political views or her position on Vietnam. That is not my judgment.
George, I'm damn glad we're here.
Even if you can't get across.
Of course. Absolutely. Look at the congregation of press. Look at the congregation of people who are going to go home and tell their constituents that things are not just terrific in Cambodia.
How was it for you personally? Are you very tired personally?
No.
How do you feel?
No.
You feel fine?
Well, of course I feel fine. I love marches, actually.
Thank you. You've got a lot of experience in it, right?
Thailand's border patrol stopped the marchers a few yards from the Khlong Luk Bridge that separates Cambodia from Thailand. Leo Chern, president of the International Rescue Committee, Dr. Claude Malouret, secretary of the MSF, and a Cambodian interpreter requested permission to bring the 20 truckloads of food and medicine into Cambodia. They were greeted by stony silence from the other side. A symbolic sit-in ended the march. The food and medicine intended for the starving people of Cambodia were handed over to the Thai Red Cross to be distributed inside the refugee camps in Thailand. With determination, courage, and dedication, one person can make a difference. And this difference can be a matter of life and death to millions of people all over the world. How does Joan Baez see the future of Cambodia?
Very pessimistic. I think that the things that we're doing and even this demonstration in February, it's just absolutely cosmetic. I mean, it's just trying to keep people fed and keep people aware of the fact that, partly for me, I'm going because Iran and Afghanistan made it look as though Cambodia never existed. No, and the problem is the same or worse or will get worse, and that's all. And just to bring attention back to it, but what's really needed for Cambodia is an international conference or a United Nations conference, mm-hmm. somebody to help politically redesign that country so that it has a chance of the remaining half of the population staying alive and going home and not being killed by the crossfire of a bunch of insane factions.
No more tiring.
In her autobiography, Daybreak, Joan Baez writes, "To sing is to love and to affirm, to coast into the hearts of people who listen, to tell them that life is to live, that love is there, that beauty exists and must be hunted for and found. Thank you, God, for giving me eyes to see the daffodils lean in the wind. All my brothers and sisters for giving me ears to hear crying, legs to come running, and a voice to laugh with and sing with. As long as there are children playing in the streets, I will sing and weep and laugh."
Joan, I'd like to know a little more about the person behind Joan Baez. Being so involved in all this, you've been married and divorced, you have a son. How much of time do you have for yourself? Do you feel lonely?
Yeah, sure I feel lonely. I think just about like everybody else in the world. I really wouldn't think much more or much less. And the reason is that my life is very full, and there are things that fill it. I would never pretend that somehow that was all I needed. You know, there are parts of my life that feel very much missing. Unfortunately, they also felt missing a lot of the time I was married. That didn't cure anything for me. I don't think it was the right marriage, and I think my husband would be happy to agree that that was true.
Mm-hmm.
But it's hard for me to tell what the Joan Baez behind me, because this is the one I know best. I think that the most honest response is that I have lonely moments like anybody else I've ever met, and that the bottom line for all of us is that devastating loneliness. And we experience it on and off, you know, when whatever the affair is begins to go sour and you think, oh my God, it's just me again. I'm perfectly aware that I'm at my happiest and healthiest when I'm very much wrapped up in politics. I'm aware that music plays a secondary role in my life, and it doesn't seem to be much I can do about that except try to be conscientious about the music and keep it up. I enjoy singing, I enjoy doing the concerts, but the real driving force and excitement in my life is when I'm involved with other people or in a project like the one now. Let's go on.